We're going to go ahead and get started. We're a few minutes after four. So good afternoon, everybody, and thank you all for joining the CCAS Global Change Fellows for our last seminar of the year. My name is Lily Ray, and I'm a current Global Change Fellow and first-year PhD student in the Marine Earth and Atmospheric Sciences Department. Before we get started, I'd like to remind all attendees to please keep your cameras off, keep yourselves muted throughout the entire seminar. I'd like to give a short introduction of our three panelists now. First off, Dr. Kenzie Krocak is a research scientist at the University of Oklahoma Institute for Public Policy Research and Analysis. She creates and distributes public surveys in order to understand how different demographic groups react to and understand severe weather communications. Joseph Trujillo Falcon is a graduate research assistant at the Cooperative Institute for Severe Weather Research and Operations at OU, where he researches crisis communication within Spanish-speaking communities. He's also a bilingual meteorologist for MyRadar, and he serves as chair of the AMS Committee for Hispanic and Latinx Advancement, or CHALA. Finally, Max Cawley is the Director of Climate Research and Engagement for the Museum of Life and Science in Durham, North Carolina. He's an educator, researcher, evaluator, and science communicator with the museum, and he focuses on participatory and responsible science through public engagement. Without further ado, please join me in welcoming our first speaker, Dr. Kenzie Krocak.
Awesome, thank you for that introduction, Lily. All right. So I'm going to talk quickly about some of the research that we do at the University of Oklahoma, where we really try to understand how people are using severe and tropical and winter weather information to make decisions. We can go to the next slide. So really boiling it down to the basics of risk communication, we define it here as the exchange of information, advice, and opinions between experts and officials. And people who face a threat to their survival, whether that's health, economic, or social well-being. And in the weather enterprise, the main objective is to provide partners and members of the public with accurate and timely information in the form of forecasts and warnings that they then can use to make decisions that result in the protection of life and property. And now in the schematic here on the right, we have information senders on the left-hand side. And in this context, we really think of that as forecasters and partners like emergency managers. And then we have receivers on the right-hand side, which as well include partners like emergency managers. They receive and send information, and then also members of the public. You'll note that generally that arrow is a little bit bigger going from senders to receivers, but risk communication is really at its best when there is information flowing in both directions. Now, in meteorology, there's a whole lot of research that looks at characteristics of the forecast, what we can forecast and when and how accurately, et cetera. But really what we focus on are characteristics of the audience and characteristics of the message, how those things can change how that information is used and how people make decisions. Today, I'm really going to be focusing on characteristics of the audience and giving an overview of how we actually study people and what decisions they're making. If you go to the next slide. When we talk about characteristics of the audience, we know that accurate and timely forecasts and warnings alone do not result in the protection of life and property. It would be much easier if it did, but instead people have to get that information or receive it and then know what it means and believe it is true and believe that it's for them personally, and then they have to take some kind of action in response. And so we generally refer to that as reception, comprehension, trust, and response in this context. And when we are characterizing the audience, we ask questions like, how do people receive forecast and warning and information? Do they know how to interpret it? Do they trust that it's for them? And then what factors can affect warning response? Next slide. Most of the data that I'm going to be sharing today comes from the Extreme Weather and Society Survey, which is an annual survey fielded by OU IPRA that measures these concepts: reception, comprehension, trust, and response. Now, we do this for right now, three different hazards. We're about to start a flooding survey as well. But for right now, we have severe weather, which we started in 2017, and then tropical weather started in 2020, and winter weather started in 2021. We generally have between 1 and 3,000 respondents every year for every hazard. So that means that we now currently have about 15,000 survey respondents that we're analyzing. It's an online survey, and in general, it's representative of the US population according to the census. Now on the right-hand side here, you see a screenshot of what we call the Extreme Weather and Society Dashboard, which is actually an interactive platform that you can go and click on each county, or right now I'm showing county warning areas from the Weather Service, but you can also see the tabs at the top in purple. If you go to the Explore Survey tab, you can see every question that we've ever asked, and there's even a search bar where you can look at, you know, how many questions do we ask about map comprehension? You can type in the word map and see what questions we ask. So I have the link at the end, I believe, or if not, I'll make sure that Lily has it. But this is a really cool interactive platform where you can really interact with the survey data and see what we've been asking. Next slide. So let's start out by looking at forecast and warning reception. So we were really interested in how people receive their forecast and warning information and whether or not there are differences across segments of the population. Can we sort of envision what the future of forecast information is going to look like? Next slide. So in general, what we're looking at here on the y-axis is the mean reliance. So when we say, how often do you personally rely on each of the following sources? The higher the dot on this graph, the more that people generally rely on these sources for weather information. And what we see is there is some variation across hazards. But one thing I really want to point out on this slide is that if you look at the purple or the darker dots, phone notifications in 2022 actually eclipsed television as the most popular source of information in the severe weather domain for the first time ever. So we really had traditionally seen television being the most popular source for severe weather information, and that changed in 2022. If you go to the next slide, we might start to see why that might be happening. So this is now broken down by age. So on the left-hand side of these lines are our younger respondents, and on the right-hand side of these lines are our older respondents. And what you see if you look at television is that older respondents have a higher mean reliance than younger respondents. So older people are looking to television for their weather information more than younger people are. The exact opposite is true for internet websites, phone notifications, friends and family, and particularly social media. So if you look at the social media column in that sort of light green, this is pretty much the strongest trend that we see in our data. Young people are using social media to get weather information. Older people are not. It's really not surprising, but when looking at this data, you can sort of imagine at least two different futures here. One, where maybe our younger respondents, as they get older and older, start to adopt the information habits of the older respondents right now. So maybe television remains pretty popular. What I think is probably more likely is that as younger respondents get older and older, they're going to maintain their information seeking habits. And we're going to continue to see a decline in the use of television and an increase in the use of things like websites, social media, and phone notifications. Next slide. In addition to just where people get their information from, we know that context is also important. So we said if a tornado warning were issued for your area tomorrow at a randomized time, how confident are you that you would receive that warning? And what we see is that from 8 a.m. till about 10 p.m. on this graph, the percentage of respondents who are either very or extremely confident remains relatively consistent. Those lines are pretty flat. But then as you get to 10 p.m., 11 p.m., and midnight, that confidence in receiving a tornado warning really drops off and then bottoms out between midnight and 4 a.m. So we see that if you're issuing a tornado warning overnight, people are a lot less confident that they're even going to get that information, say nothing of be able to make any decisions using it. Notably, though, this is less of an issue for people who rely on multiple sources of information. So continuing to encourage things like have multiple ways to get warnings, you know, have a weather radio, make sure your phone notifications are turned on, things like that really help people be more confident that they're going to receive that information. Next slide. If we focus on comprehension here for a minute, so assuming that someone gets the warning, do they know how to interpret it? Next slide. When we give people the text definition of a tornado watch or a warning, so this alert is issued when tornadoes are possible in the area, it does not mean they will occur, but only means they are possible. About 75% of our survey respondents can correctly identify that as a tornado watch. Whereas when we say this alert is used when a tornado is imminent, well, again, about 75 or 80% of respondents can correctly identify that as a tornado warning. So most people know the basic difference between a watch and a warning. If you've ever seen those memes of like, here are the ingredients for a taco and here's a taco, the ingredients are the watch and the taco is the warning, those things are working. People generally know those differences. If you go to the next slide though, We know that it's not just important that people know they can recite the definitions, but that they actually know what the characteristics of these products are, like how much time you have to respond. And so when we say, if the Weather Service issues a warning for your area, how much time do you have before the tornado arrives? We have about 60% of our respondents saying less than an hour. But that means that about 40% of our respondents think that they have more than an hour to respond when a tornado warning is issued. And for reference, a tornado warning's average lead time before the tornado occurs in a location is about 15 minutes. So we're talking a pretty big gap here in how much time people think they have versus how much time they actually have. Even a little more concerning is that if you break down those folks who said less than an hour and look on the right-hand side of this graphic, this is that distribution when we ask, okay, how many minutes do you have? And again, a lot of people who said less than an hour still think that you have maybe 30 minutes or more to respond to a warning. So we need to remember that comprehension is about more than just the text definitions, but actually these characteristics of the products too. Next slide. Okay, so you've gotten the warning, you understand what it means, now do you trust it? Next slide. When we ask, please indicate your level of trust in the following information sources, we see that the Weather Service has a mean trust of over 4.0, and this is on a 5-point scale. So in general, that's really high. I mean, across a couple thousand respondents, that's a really high mean. So in general, people really trust the Weather Service. They also really trust national TV stations, state and local emergency managers, and regional or local TV stations as well. There is less trust for friends, family, neighbors, et cetera, which I think is interesting just because you see, especially young people going to friends and family and social media much more often than older respondents, even though trust is a little bit lower. Next slide. Now, when we look at what factors affect trust in a forecast, we see that in general, the accuracy of recent forecasts is really important. So being accurate is still very, very important, and we want to keep working on that. But so is the amount of information that a forecast provides. So the more details you can give as a forecaster, generally the higher people perceive you, the higher trust people perceive that you have. Less important is their view about how reasonable the forecast seems, or the decisions they're trying to make, or the exact person who made the forecast. So in general, if you can include those details, possible reasons why this might be occurring, maybe why the forecast has changed, that tends to increase perceptions of trust in that information. Next slide. Okay, so we've received the information, we understand it, we trust it. Now, what are you going to do with that? Next slide. In general, we know that response is very idiosyncratic. It's really personal. In general, most people plan to act in response to warnings, but life does intervene. I'm a meteorologist by training. I study how people make decisions using weather information. And yet every once in a while, I still get kind of caught off guard. And it takes me a minute to figure out how to get the cats in the cat carrier, for example. So everyone's got that external factor that they're dealing with. In general, though, there are some variables that systematically relate to response, including risk appraisals or the question, am I at risk? And then coping appraisals. Is there something I can reasonably do that's going to reduce that risk? And when we ask a couple questions, we ask people to agree or disagree with the following statements. One of them is, I can protect myself against a tornado. We see that 15% of our survey respondents are disagreeing or strongly disagreeing with that statement. Similarly, if we say, I'm not sure what to do when tornado warnings are issued for my area, we see 20% of our respondents agreeing with that statement. So we've got a reasonable proportion of the population, or our sample, I should say, saying that they either can't protect themselves from a tornado or they don't know how. And those are really the people that I think that we should be focusing on when we talk about response. If you go to the next slide, I believe... Yeah. So I just say here to make sure that people know that they can do something and that we are, as meteorologists, as forecasters, as communicators, we are suggesting options of what people can do. Oftentimes, especially when we talk about tornadoes, we say things like, you got to get underground or you're going to die. That is, first off, just simply not true in most scenarios. And in general, then if people have no way to get underground, if they don't have a basement or they don't have a shelter, then they are much less likely to seek out other options than if you were to provide them with a list of options to begin with. Next slide. All right, so I didn't figure out what time I actually started, but I'll just leave the key points and takeaways here. When you're talking about reception, most people get their information from multiple sources, but those sources are changing. I really think that internet websites, phone notifications are going to start to dominate the weather information ecosystem. When we talk about comprehension, most people know those basic definitions, but there is some confusion about how much time you have to respond. So including those details is important. And then when we talk about trust, trust is really high, especially for National Weather Service meteorologists, emergency managers, and broadcast meteorologists. And then when we talk about response, we have to remember that almost everyone plans to take protective action, but sometimes life gets in the way. And explaining those best response options is generally really important, particularly to those who are unfamiliar with a particular hazard. And with that, I will say thank you, and we will get on to the next speaker.
Thank you, Kenzie. We will go ahead and pass it to Joseph now.
Thank you so much, Lily, and fantastic presentation, Dr. Kenzie Krocak. Always wonderful to see those updates from the national surveys. I'm so delighted to be here with everyone today to give you a new perspective, really, and how we, you know, just the composition of the public itself. We've done an amazing job, as Kenzie just indicated, through these national surveys and expanding how we communicate to the public. Of course, as our communities continue to expand and diversify, it's also very, very important that we move beyond the language barrier and address some things that might not have necessarily been addressed yet. And today I'm so excited to talk to you about looking at weather and climate communication into other languages, how that looks like, the challenges we face, and the opportunities that we have along the way to really integrate everyone, no matter where they come from or what language they speak, in the risk communication process. Today, I'm delighted to give you two perspectives. First off, the one from the public. Of course, how are they currently responding to extreme weather events? And of course, a practitioner perspective as well, because there's been recent advances, especially in the bilingual weather and climate communication space, to expand services to people that do speak Spanish here in the United States. And so with that, next slide, please. First off, I want to begin a little bit with the public perspective, just because it's very important that we address some things, especially for multilingual communities, and really understanding, you know, how they go about receiving and eventually responding to information. And I always like to kick things off with a story, because this just happened 10 years ago, right down the street from where I'm currently based at in Norman, Oklahoma. There was an incoming tornado towards the Oklahoma City metro area, and the sirens started wailing all across town. And of course, people were prompted to act. There was coverage on television and wherever you name it of a confirmed tornado headed its way back in May 31st, 2013. However, information was only available in English at that time. The only Spanish-speaking station had to go seek shelter. And so for a lot of people that did not speak English on that day, when that incoming tornado was headed their way, really all they could depend on was sirens. And that's exactly what a Spanish-speaking family of seven wanted to go do. They heard the sirens and decided to take action. Hearing that there was also a tornado warning, they went to go seek shelter underneath a storm drain with their family. The really heartbreaking part of this story, however, is that there was not only a tornado warning in effect, but also a flash flood warning. Next slide, please. I'd love to introduce to you La Familia Cifuentes y Ferraz Santos, seven of nine Spanish speakers that were taken from us back in May 31st of 2013 during the big tornado outbreak in Oklahoma and surrounding regions. You know, this goes to show one of many instances when language and equities really do come into play, and it's a difference between life and death. We have to make sure that we communicate this information so that everyone is able to understand it. And as a result of this event, it sparked a nationwide conversation for how we go about addressing language inequities in the future. The National Weather Service did end up stepping up. They developed volunteer translation teams across the agency so that even to this day, we now have two nationwide translation teams that are able to translate information from English to Spanish in the short term and even in educational campaigns. However, all of these, note the word volunteer, still at the grassroots level. We can only do so much at that level. There's nobody up in headquarters that's able to organize all of the efforts happening at once. And with a lot of local efforts happening all at once, you can really see how the inconsistencies come into play. Next slide, please. And so here's a glimpse of how this looks like today, where, you know, whether you're, for example, if you check some of the National Weather Service Weather Forecast Office's Twitter pages, you might see people define, for example, tornado watch and warning one way, while the FEMA and Espanol page uses completely different words to communicate the same message. It's not only just a different translation, but you're communicating different contexts, different protective actions as a result. And we actually collaborated with Dr. Kenzie Krocak and her entire team to conduct a nationwide survey of Spanish speakers, from just based on Spanish speakers, one representative of the U.S. sample census. And we went to go find that when it came to tornado watch and understanding, where 66% of English speakers correctly identified a tornado watch of the given descriptions, only 38% of Spanish speakers were able to do so. This is with 2 decades worth of outreach on television, outreach educational campaigns nationwide, and trying to get the word out. You can clearly see through the graph there that the language inequities still exist today. And without efforts staying at the grassroots level, we can't advance far enough to really reach the most underserved. And this isn't a problem of if this gets worse in the future, but when? Next slide, please. Instituto Cervantes, back in 2022, most recently, actually, went to go estimate the number of Spanish speakers from all across the world. And present day, we rank number 5, and that's including all of Latin America and Spain. We currently have 41 million Spanish speakers here in the United States. Next, please. And that number is only expected to grow. Now, by 2060, it is estimated that there will be 119 million Spanish speakers in the United States. Next, please. That is nearly 1 in every 4 Americans. And so, of course, these language inequities are only going to happen more frequently, result in more consequences as we faced back in 2013, and more of those events will keep happening. Because as a matter of fact, I tell you, the first time the Weather Service ever documented a death related to language inequities traces back all the way to 1970. Next slide, please. And so it's not just a matter of getting the translation right. It's ensuring that we also understand where these communities come from. Because say you can have the best translation in the world from English to Spanish, but you also have to acknowledge that especially places in Latin America don't experience extreme weather events at the same magnitude that we in the U.S. here do as well. Next, please. So get taken into consideration. I come from Lima, Peru. I experienced earthquakes growing up. And whenever I moved to Dallas-Fort Worth, I was so just shocked because the sky suddenly started exploding, thunderstorms, hail, tornadoes, the completely different landscape, a different emergency system too that I had to get adapted to. And if we can click next 2 times, please. And, you know, experiences in Peru are very different than Puerto Rico, for example, where they just faced a significant hurricane just in the very last couple of years, and their emergency infrastructures are geared for that. Next, please. And Argentina, where they just broke records for gargantuan hail. It is, of course, we need to, going forward at least, have to make sure that Hispanic and Latinos aren't just one category. We come from different parts of Latin America. And, of course, speaking different languages, dialects, and even experiencing different climates, too. And next slide, please. Which brings me to the climate perspective. Because even the word weather versus climate isn't differentiated as much in Spanish as it is in English. And whenever we're communicating climate change, that can also even get in the way of just fundamentally defining what weather versus climate means. Because in Spanish, technically, the word for weather is el tiempo, and the word for climate is el clima. However, that's used interchangeably in Latin America, whether you look at different Twitter outlets, different news agencies from Mexico, Guatemala, Spain, the U.S., you call it, people are using weather and climate interchangeably in Spanish. And so you can also see how this could create some confusion when communicating weather in the short term versus climate in the long term. Next, please. And so that leads me to the practitioner, because this is where they are most effective in communicating this message, making sure that the community understands not just the translations, the implications of extreme weather hazards, and of course, how that also links to the evolving climate that we live today, and how we can most importantly take action against it. And so what our team decided to do just last year was conduct a nationwide survey of bilingual broadcast meteorologists in the nation. Well, you know, bilingual broadcast meteorology goes all the way back to the early 90s, really. It's something particularly new, if you would call it that, because in Latin America, there weren't really established meteorologists that would continually actively look at the weather. And we have established that culture here in the United States only very recently. And now we have bilingual broadcast meteorologists, especially in big urban areas. But to this day, there's rural areas in the United States that does not have a Spanish-speaking station. Next, please. And there's been studies done on just the whole concept of climate and climate change and how that's currently being communicated in Latin America. Just because it has rose in prominence, especially as more and more people are starting to feel the implications of climate change. However, recent studies show that the journalistic practices behind these articles and highlights are just translations mainly from English language media. And that's very, very important because of the translation issues I just spoke of, in addition to there not even being a weather and climate dictionary, an official one in the United States for that sort of terminology. And so, of course, within Latin America, they have their own issues in addressing climate change to their communities because of incorporating, especially incorporating criticism and climate solutions, especially in state-funded medias like Cuba, which is one of these studies kind of centralized their efforts in. But here in the United States, we've been trying to advance that through broadcast meteorologists on television. Next slide, please. And so you can tune in to any Univision or Telemundo station, and people are talking about climate more and more often. Telemundo National News actually just did a whole special on climate change and was able to air an hour-long story on just the effects of it. And every year, whether it be a national chain or a local chain, Spanish-speaking stations across the United States are talking about this. And, especially with work done in George Mason and the Climate Communication Center, we have found that the scientist the American public is most familiar with is the broadcast meteorologist. And in current surveys of Spanish-speaking communities, 4 in 5 Spanish speakers still mainly rely on television. The second place on all of that was social media with only 2 in 5 or 40%. But nearly 80% of Spanish speakers still watch television because these are the main outlets for Spanish speakers that may not be familiar with their local leadership or government, where they mostly count on the newscasters to really be able to give them a way and access to all of the community resources and updates that they may have and in their own language. And in this national survey, we asked, there's only about 80 bilingual broadcast meteorologists on television, and we were able to get around 40 of them. And with those, we managed to ask them the questions related to the scope of their profession, how managerial support still kicks in, like whether their news bandwidth supports climate change stories in Spanish. Of course, the terminology, since I just mentioned that clima and tiempo are used interchangeably, and then what kind of stories are they putting on air? And these following slides are some of the results from that. Next slide, please. And so, yeah, this survey was done with different Telemundo, Univision, and even some national chains like the Weather Channel and Español. And so it was a study of nearly 40 or 38 bilingual broadcast meteorologists. And first, we wanted to just ask them about the role of their profession. Reporting climate change a part of a bilingual meteorologist's role? Not just as a scientist, but as a member of your own community. I know, especially in Hispanic and Latinx communities, camaraderie is so, so important, and broadcasters agree, whether it be on air or off air, and they also believe that it is a role to communicate this as a member of an underserved group. So not only are we just communicating the story and the implications of climate change, but also through a perspective of a member of an underserved group, which personalizes it and makes it just so effective. Next slide, please. Which brings me to managerial support. Are news managers across television networks supporting these kinds of efforts? There's been studies on this in English language markets, but we wanted to get a better understanding of Spanish language markets and see whether there was any sort of differentiation. And for the most part, as you can see there, whether it be on air for mainly or in long form segments even, news management is supporting communicating climate change across bilingual broadcast stations nationwide. Next slide, please. And I have this fun little graphic for you because, at least in the American public and the U.S. Spanish-speaking public, there's no really solid differentiation between el tiempo and clima, or weather and climate. I'm happy to report that 100%, so yes or yes in purple, of all bilingual broadcast meteorologist surveys are emphasizing this difference between weather and climate in Spanish. They're letting their viewers know weather or el tiempo is short-term, clima or climate is long term. And that's why whenever we say cambio climático or climate change, we are talking about everything in the long term. I know it might be a small distinction, but a very important one as we're communicating our messages forward. Next slide, please. And lastly, we wanted to see what kind of stories bilingual broadcasters share. And 81.4% of respondents mentioned that mainly stories are based on the local levels. You know, what's happening in my neighborhood? How is climate change affecting my local community? However, this is very important because as I just shared with you, we come from different parts of Latin America and Spain and other Spanish-speaking countries around the world. Especially for immigrants that recently immigrated here, home might not necessarily be your local neighborhood. Home, for example, if you ask me where I'm from, I will always tell you Peru. I have great, I'm very proud to be Peruvian. And whenever people get asked where you come from or where's your hometown, they will always mention that heritage or that country of origin. And only to this day, 36% of broadcasters are focusing on international stories. That's actually one way we can improve our climate communication in other languages. Start linking climate change implications, not just to what's happening in my neighborhood, but also where people come from and their cultures and their different places where they live, because that's where their families are. That's where it really hits home that this is something that's evolving and something we need to take action. Next slide, please. And so these are just some of the key takeaways from our national survey of broadcast meteorologists. We currently presented it at the AMS annual conference, and we're currently currently writing this up to submit to a journal. But here's just a summary of what I just mentioned, that of course, bilingual broadcasters are stepping up to the challenge with 4 in 5 Spanish speakers watching television on a daily basis. It's so important that these people, that these practitioners are leading these efforts, because these are the scientists that they trust the most, and in Spanish-speaking communities are able to more effectively engage them in these sorts of things, differentiating the important terms. But again, a lot of this is still held back by a lot of the grassroots efforts. The fact that we haven't instated a multilingual emergency communication system in the United States. You know, broadcasting is really just the first step. We need to reimagine our emergency system and incorporate all languages and cultures for it to truly be a weather-ready nation for all and a climate-ready nation for all. Next slide, please. So with that, I just wanted to say thank you so much. Here's some of my contact information in case you ever have questions about how you can even expand your research or practices into other languages. Always happy here to provide you with tools and resources, as there's many out there. So with that, I'd love to toss it to the next speaker. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Joseph, for that wonderful presentation. We will go ahead and hand it off to our last speaker, Max.
Hey, thanks, Lily. Thanks also to all of y'all for making some time this afternoon. And thanks especially to my fellow speakers. I have learned an awful lot and learned some actionable lessons to incorporate into my own practice. So I appreciate y'all. My name is Max Cawley. I work at the Museum of Life and Science in Durham, North Carolina. So I work at a science museum, and a lot of what makes me most excited about this presentation is the incorporation of perspectives from different pieces of the sort of knowledge dissemination complex, right? All three speakers sort of work in different parts of risk communication, and that's a piece of this that I'm very, very excited about. When I try to contextualize what risk communication kind of means to me and how I might make use of very limited time this afternoon, I hope that most of this will come across as mostly posing some evocative questions about your own work and talking through how I conceptualize and think about this sort of thing, which is, again, mostly through thinking through some sometimes kind of challenging questions. I also want to apologize in advance. This is probably the least visually appealing presentation that I've ever made. So apologies, especially to, you know, science communicators and graphic designers that are in the audience. I tried to pare down a lot of this so that it was only giving really the most basic and essential information in word form. And that unto itself is a risk communication tool. So the way I conceptualize risk communication is in this question: how can I support someone in making an informed judgment in a time of crisis? You can go to the next slide. Risk communication encompasses how and what you do as a disaster is occurring or is about to occur. and incorporates how you communicate, what words you choose, how you're saying them, when and where you're saying them, but it also encompasses a set of practices that can and should be set in motion far earlier so that people can have access to knowledge and information they have a right to and that they need to know about what risks they may or do encounter. You may know some things climatologically or meteorologically or hydrologically or geologically that are risky to someone, to a person, but you probably don't know their ontology, how they live their lives, where they get their information, who they trust, all of which funnels directly into the incredibly complex information ecosystem in which people make decisions about their own health and the health of their loved ones. Fundamentally, the facts, the science of what's risky to people, these are a small part of people, of how people contextualize their lives and make a decision. If you can't be bothered to understand at least some of the rest of this context, the character, the nature, the culture, the history, the values, the belief systems of these communities, then you're missing out on understanding what I would posit is how most of someone thinks about the things like their own risk. This takes humility. It takes setting aside your own expertise and recognizing that we need to work with people in order to work in service of them. That risk communication is not simply that people need the information and the knowledge that you have and that you can convey to them. This deficit model of learning, one that assumes that all someone needs is your technical knowledge about a climate risk to make a more informed decision, misses that we as humans tend to be irrational in our decision-making, and this irrationality is only escalated and more pronounced when tensions are high, like right before or during a disaster. These processes are broader than a set of principles for when a climate event occurs. They are about a holistic approach towards leveraging expertise to help people make informed decisions about the right choices for their own context. How much risk tolerance one has, what the history and trust of a community is, what the relationship to science with the community might be, how people in a community perceive themselves, their place, and their risks are all vital pieces to consider here. So I'm going to use my short session of time today and contextualize it in a risk communication framework, a paradigm that some of y'all might be familiar with, which is a 27-9-3. 27-9-3 comes to us directly from risk communication studies, which tells us that in a time of crisis, when emotions are high and decisions need to be made urgently, people tend to not be able to process massive amounts of information. You probably only have 27 words that you can get your message across. You have about 9 seconds to do it in, and you have 3 key messages that you can get across. These are the 3 that I've chosen for this talk. The first, there's no such thing as a general public. The second, risk communication happens at all phases of risk. And the third is that people's perception of risk are different and context dependent. I'm going to spend a little bit of time exploring each one of these. You can go to the next slide. So if your attempt to reach everyone is via a strategy aimed at what I believe is a fictional general audience when it comes to science communication, you will indeed not reach everybody. Who you will reach is the typical users that the systems we've been told were for general audiences are designed for. This is a predictable audience. It's the same that most, if not all, Western science frameworks were built for. It is mostly for affluent people, mostly for people with more free time, mostly for people with access to resources, and mostly for white people. These are also people whose risk tends to be a bit lower, which is not to say that they do not themselves experience risk, but that the systems to mitigate and communicate risk to them actually tend to work quite well. On the other hand, both risk, hazard, and rebuilding are harder in communities that do not fit within these boxes. And communication, not incidentally, is more difficult from this current paradigm. If you intend to reach a general audience, you will generally use a system intended and designed to reach people that are probably already predisposed to hear and react to your message, and who are more likely to already have the resources, time, and assets in place to respond to your message. You will reach the audience and the learners that these systems were initially designed to reach. Equity in risk communication demands that we do more to serve a broader swathe of publics, and this requires us to take a different approach, one that recognizes and communicates, one that recognizes that communities historically disenfranchised from the scientific enterprise, systematically excluded from a great deal of how knowledge and information are generated and disseminated, those will require a different approach to reach them. Reach in communities not typically reached via the most direct and accessible channels available to us as communicators is a worthwhile and important challenge, but a challenge nonetheless, and it's important to recognize that. You will need to identify specifically the people you are intending to reach and how you might go about reaching them, and recognize that the answers to these questions may indeed be quite challenging. It will begin almost certainly with attempting to find and support local established pillars of trust within these communities, local leaders who you are willing to work with and support, who are willing to work with you. And yes, this often means funding as being an entry point into these communities. It is likely that people will not immediately trust you or your message, and that's for good reason, and that trust is not immediately owed, but can and should be built over time. Trust and collaboration as key points for risk communication demand reciprocity and mutual learning. They require time, investment, and a great deal of patience. Here in North Carolina, one group particularly imperiled by extreme heat, a climate hazard we're familiar with, is guest workers, often farm and field workers from countries of different origin who are both imperiled both by the climate hazard itself, but also imperiled by virtue of their relative social isolation and deliberate exclusion due to citizenship status and economic disenfranchisement. Traditional attempting to communicate directly with this audience that is experiencing climate hazard and risk have not traditionally worked tremendously well. We've come to understand that a major barrier here is not only linguistic barriers or cultural relevance, but also the fact that many guest workers are not aware of what county they are currently in. And this is actually true for many other people as well, including stakeholder groups like tourists. A reliance on place-based knowledge in order to understand climate risk, therefore, for example, if you're in Sampson County, you need to prepare for an extreme heat event, will miss people that don't know that they're in Sampson County. It will be ineffective at reaching some of the people that might be able to make use of this information the most. Relying instead on working with, trusting, and preparing trusted community assets like local community health workers, advocates, and community leaders to effectively prepare and work alongside local both parties will help understand existing pathways for risk communication, including and centrally, in this case, broadcasting on local Spanish-speaking radio stations and making use of assets like Facebook groups. You can go to the next slide. Our strategy for risk communication should not start and end as a hazard or disaster is approaching or falling upon a community. Risk communication fundamentally should be similar to how we hope most communication goes. It should be longer term conversation and collaboration, one in which we build understanding together rather than assuming that we know what the truth is and that everybody else just needs to hear it. Ideally, we should not have people hear about the risk for the first time as it is about to bear down on top of them. Ideally, someone should also not have to hear about their risk for the first time in a really impersonal way, like a newspaper. Ideally, scientific facts that could change someone's calculus about the risk would be encountered earlier and in a way that is contextually and culturally relevant to them, presented and discussed with them in a way where they're able to access and make use of it. Human decision-making is a deeply complex and contextually relevant process. It is both highly unpredictable and at best, pretty irrational process. What we know for certain is that in a conversation like this, where we're discussing really deeply personal things about people's options or how much risk they are encountering, the presence of scientific evidence alone, be it new evidence, better evidence, more granular evidence, does little to actually change somebody's calculus or plans. A great deal of a person's decision-making is based on their context, their values, their belief systems, the opinions of their friends and loved ones, the importance and sense of place and belonging, how hungry they are, how much sleep they've had recently. If we hope to have scientific data influence decision-making at all in these moments, the time to introduce that data is not in a moment of crisis, when we know that their heightened sense of endangerment means that their capacity to process and make use of new and complex data will be overwhelmed by anxiety, concern, or fear. We know that in moments like those, people need to know as quickly as possible, not about why something is occurring, not about how rare it is, not about how novel or interesting or fascinating the event is, but the necessary information that they need in order to make an informed decision. But before that time, is a vital opportunity for sustained and proactive engagement with these communities, understanding their priorities and perspectives, and building sufficient trust together to build new knowledge about what exactly is risky to them. Risk communication, this dialogue and building of understanding and trust between practitioners and the publics that we hope to serve, must start long before a risk presents itself as a tangible and imminent hazard, and continue through the process of a community understanding and making informed decisions about their own risks. This takes time. Our risk communication strategies have to be more multidirectional, have to be more collaborative, and have to elevate local expertise and knowledge that people have about the places that they live. The onus is on us, expert science, to bend over backwards to meet people where they are to begin these collaborations. And it will require things like humility, trust building, and power sharing, some things that, if we're honest, Western science has not always excelled at. Breaking down the barriers and broken trust between communities that have been most disenfranchised from the scientific enterprise will take time, and the responsibility lies with us motivated practitioners. But we'll talk about that more in the third point. You can go to the last slide here, which is people's perception of risk are different and context dependent. When we talk about risk communication, a piece of it is understanding and communicating about tangible hazards, about qualifying and communicating degrees of physical phenomena. This is different from the concept of risk. Risk as a concept is a living being. It's one that changes over time and context and cultural boundaries. It is how people perceive of themselves being imperiled. And we don't view all hazards, fear, dread, or risk the same. It's emotive, it's personal, it's variable. What risk means to us as practitioners will necessarily be different than what risk means to somebody living two states away from us in a different country, than somebody currently experiencing a hurricane or down the road or next door to you. Risk is not universally defined, and people do not categorize or find the same things risky or the same degree of risky. Some of this comes down to things like tolerance or lived experience. For example, and here's a question, how long after a piece of food has been sitting on the floor does that piece of food become risky? You might say that that's a silly question because how dirty is the floor? What sort of food is it? Of course, the answer is 5 seconds, or of course, the answer is 5 minutes. If you've lived through eating something off of the floor plenty of times, or your house is really clean, your perception of risk is probably different from somebody with food sensitivity issues. That is context. A lot of it comes down to other tangible or intangible things like how well we understand the consequences or the degree to which the risk is voluntary. Skiing, for example, is a highly risky activity if you were going to ask me, if you choose to do it. Perhaps you decide not to because you've seen how many people have gotten injured skiing, and perhaps you choose to because most people don't get injured and it's fun and it's an important thing to me. Or maybe you see somebody getting injured skiing and say, well, actually it's not risky because they chose to participate in, so it's kind of their fault. This is more context. What if somebody purchases a home on a coastline that's eroding? Does the riskiness or calculation change if that's their second home or a vacation home? What if it was their parents' home or the home that they grew up in? What if the person knew how far the ocean would encroach on their property? Or what if they should have known? How do those pieces of context change the risk calculus? Be as specific as you possibly can when describing a community. If and whenever possible, allow a community to describe themselves in their own terms and language. Be specific and intentional with the language and the words you choose to and decide to use in your own practice. Always consider, does what I'm saying potentially imply a deficit, imply a responsibility, imply a fault on the part of this community? Will my words break trust with my partners, or worse, will it actually harm them? I work in a bit in some rural coastal communities here in North Carolina along the coastline who've lived through multiple strong storms and are no strangers to building, rebuilding, and adapting to strong and severe storms. The conversations that I have there are often about self-reliance, about rebuilding, about a strong sense of independence, and fundamentally not about leaving. And to be honest, sometimes paired with shaming people who did decide to leave. Lots and lots of community engagement and inquiry later, there was an enormous concern for a lot of their venerable cultural assets, including and particularly the burial sites of many generations of these people's ancestors. Many of their descendants still carry their last names. The conversation about risks associated with these invaluable cultural assets and spaces was incredibly different than the conversations associated with a more traditional lens of risk communication framework. Much of the conversation shifted to what could be changed, how could we protect, and how might we solicit help and further understanding to preserve and protect the things that I love about my community, rather than focusing on deficit or risk. This strategy, an affirmative inquiry process focused on understanding what people love and value and hope to preserve and protect, gives us as professionals, practitioners, and communicators tools to better change and inform our work to be more inclusive of community priorities, values, and expertise. I had the opportunity to be in that space with an environmental historian, Matthew Booker, recently. I'm going to paraphrase here that he said when we were there that no landscape, no place on earth is either purely an environmental landscape or a cultural landscape. It is always both. The environmental and cultural histories and legacy of a place are always inextricably tied to one another and affect one another. Given this, we can't and won't fully understand a place by only understanding its geography or its environmental reality alone. Knowing and understanding a place necessarily also means coming to understand the culture of the people who call that place home. This is paramount for risk communication. You may be an expert in modeling hazards, but hazards are only part of how someone perceives and understands their own risk. You haven't taken time to understand their cultural reality, their history, the people who live here, and you won't understand the risk. The fundamentally context and culturally relevant set of mental models on how someone makes decisions about their own health and the health of their family. You can go to the last slide. In this slide, I've just sort of put a glossary here of words that I think about when I think about risk communication. All of these, I think you can take some time if you're interested to look up on your own. Sometimes I just Google risk communication and mental models, or risk communication and uncertainty. I think all of these are important for understanding some of these holistic pieces on how we might rethink and qualify what risk communication counts as. Thanks so much.
Thank you so much, Max. And thank you so much again to our three panelists. We don't have a ton of time left, but we will go ahead and open the floor to any questions you guys have. All right, we have a question from Ruxton for Max. What role do you think risk perception plays in risk communication?
This is a wonderful question. I think that communication is always a two-way street. It's always at least bi-directional. And in a community sense, if you're communicating with a larger group of people, it's multi-directional. If we are trying to avoid a model wherein it is just us approaching and talking, a didactic sort of way of communicating in which it's only one direction, then perception is always going to be a piece of that. You always need to approach a community actually willing to listen to, understand, and allow whatever those perceptions are to inform your practice, and to be ready and willing to learn from them and be surprised by it, rather than approaching a community and deciding, this is actually my area of expertise, so I know best what's for you. In this case, using perception as a way of informing your own practice and in your communication sort of tool belt is a really important way in making sure that it's not just two different people having monologues and is indeed two people trying to use a conversation to build something.
All right, we have another question for Mackenzie from Hannah. For your survey on extreme weather, can you talk more about what community of participants you focused on?
Yeah, so specifically for the survey data that I presented today, we have a demographically representative sample of the US population. So people from all across the country, from all walks of life, really representative of the US population. Hopefully that answers the question you're asking.
All right, and from Steph for Joseph and Kenzie, do you have any thoughts or responses to content that came up after your segment?
I thought I was learning quite a bit from Max as well, and so I appreciate you bringing us together here today, but I really thought that some of the things that were discussed in both of our talks were reflective in Max's overview. So props to Lily for bringing us all together.
Yeah, 100% agree. Like, I feel like, you know, Max provided such insightful information in just like setting up state. Like, I love that statement. Like, it's honestly something I'm going to, I will definitely like fight you on in the future. It's like, oh my gosh, like there is no general public. I love that sentence. And it's just so resounding because yeah, you can't say that someone, you know, speaks English, Spanish, or other languages are the same. So I just really enjoyed that. And it really did stick with me for a while. So thank y'all so much.
Our next question is from Carrie for Mackenzie. And you mentioned younger respondents using social media at much higher rates than older respondents and noted that you think that social media will only continue to become a more popular medium for receiving weather notifications. Twitter seems to be one of the best platforms for communicating these notifications, but I'm wondering if with some of the current changes the platform is undergoing, if you see Twitter continuing to be go-to, if not, will there or should there be more of an emphasis on Facebook?
No, that's a really good question. So we study a lot of social media data, and let me tell you, the changes at Twitter have been fun. But I think one thing that we are learning is that the benefits of Twitter, at least historically, were that, you know, they were really short, concise messages and that you could at least get information temporally. So you could order your feed so that the newest stuff is at the top. And with some of those things being changed, I think it's going to continue to undergo an interesting transformation. I don't really know what the future holds. I was kind of pretty convinced that Twitter was going to crash and burn pretty formally last fall, and it hasn't so far. So I think it's something that we continue to watch and study. Facebook is really challenging. Facebook is a particularly challenging platform, and I personally don't see that being an adequate replacement or, you know, playing the same role that Twitter has. But things are changing every day, so I'm sure the next big thing is around the corner.
All right, our next question is from Cassie for anyone, and they said risk can be looked at in a risk perception and risk attitude crossroads. How do you deal with possibly harder attitudes, maybe a non-climate change believer, when talking to people about risk?
At least something that has been looked at more within Spanish-speaking communities is that concept of being able to personalize and link it to things that people really do care about. I know like different communities have different you know, things that they uphold, and at least for within Spanish speaking communities, it's really about the community factor. It's like not a me, but a we sort of, and in intercultural communication studies, we really dig into how, you know, using your, you know, like embracing your culture to really be able to hone in these concepts and, you know, not looking at it maybe not from a more scientific perspective, but really it is more of the duty of us within our own communities to create this sort of change and be there for one another throughout this sort of time. And so, yeah, I've learned so much through intercultural communication. One of the specialties that I've been doing in my PhD to really dig into this, because like a lot of the time, well, yes, the science is established, but most of the times you really have to dig into who the person is individually to really be able to convince them and really get them to think a little bit about the concept of climate change and beyond.
All right, and we have another question from Sheila for Joseph. Do you have one dream program / idea that you would like the various federal U.S. agencies implement for non-English speakers, and what would that be?
Let me unload the scroll there. Not no, if there's one dream idea out there, I would love in the future for headquarters, whether it be from NOAA or the Weather Service, to actually have a designated multilingual coordinator. You know, there's other departments like NASA that actually have multilingual departments. where it's not just scientists in there, but certified translators that aren't just able to translate this from English to Spanish, but into other languages too, and are actually trained and have all the certifications necessary. You know, I actually borrowed this idea from Environment Canada, the weather service offices up to our north, where for them, it's a requirement to translate information into French. And what they do is they relay a warning in English. It gets sent out immediately in English to the public. It gets sent out to the multilingual office. They take 1 to 2 minutes max with automation already installed and just fix the minor few tweaks. And it also gets sent out in French. There are ways to go about doing this and success stories in other agencies. And so, yeah, the dream program or idea would be to have a multilingual office within NOAA and the climate centers as well that are able to not just translate it, but also be members of that community that could further personalize that and be able to encourage more people to take action in extreme and climate-related hazards.
All right, we are a little bit over time, so we're gonna wrap it up here, but if you guys have any extra questions, you can send it to our speakers and they will be happy to get back to you. Other than that, thank you again to our three panelists and thank you again to everyone who attended. We will be posting this recording on the CCAST YouTube channel shortly after the event, so be on the lookout for that. And we will also be sending follow-up emails to all of the participants, so be on the lookout. But yeah, thank you all for coming again. And I hope you all got something out of this because I know I sure did.